brought to you by Penguin.
Perfectly Imperfect Puppy, written and read by Graeme Hall. To Molly Hall, aka Mum, in gratitude for your patience and perseverance when I was a mischievous puppy. Introduction. Hi there, pup pickers. Graeme Hall here. You probably know me as the dog father, that tall bloke off the telly who wears a cravat and helps people get their dogs to stop doing naughty things. That's me. But working with slightly mischievous adult dogs is only part of what I do. A big part of my 15-year dog training career has always been about helping dog owners to choose, look after and train their new puppies. I love puppies. Who doesn't? I mean, it's a cold-hearted person who's immune to the charms of a loving, snuggly bundle of chaos puppy. And if ever I retire from dog training, I'm sure it'll be the lovely biscuity smell of puppies and the laughter that always comes from them that I'll miss the most. I also love working with puppies because there's so much potential to make a lasting difference to a dog's life and to their owners. There's an old saying, you only get one chance to make a first impression. And I always think puppy training is a bit like that. Don't get me wrong, I firmly believe that you can train any dog at any age, and I'm very proud of the fact that I've never expelled a dog from one of my classes. But if you can get it right, or, you know, right-ish, when they're a puppy, well, you're paving the way for a lifetime of reliable, good and safe behaviour. Having said that, the word training increasingly feels like a bit of a misnomer to me, because for me, having a dog is about building a partnership and about communication. It's not about creating a robot. Having managed staff in huge factories and spent many years as a special constable, I've learned that good leadership isn't about forcing your workforce or your braying crowd to do something. It's about creating a desire within them to want to do the right thing. Now, the best boss you ever had didn't shout at you or push you or shove you, although you probably wouldn't have wanted to get on the wrong side of them either. Now, subtle, calm and assertive communication, especially body language and tone of voice, will always beat bullying and demands. Now, and for me, the same principle applies with dog training. So when we're talking about training, what we're really talking about is establishing an understanding between you and your animal, talking in a language that you both speak fluently, even though you're from two entirely different species. Rather than a dog who does what they're told, I'm always aiming for a dog who understands, anticipates, and responds to you. Back when I started working with dogs, this kind of thinking was, well, it's kind of frowned upon in training and behaviour circles, where the anthropomorphisation of our dogs was considered sentimental and somehow wrong. The style back then was more authoritarian. You were meant to be the pack leader, which in reality meant bullying your dog into submission, or in the worst cases, brutalising them. Now, thankfully, dog training has come a long way since then, and I've worked with literally thousands of puppies, from the greatest of Great Danes to the tiniest of teacup toy breeds. But perhaps the two puppies who taught me the most about the joys and pains of raising young dogs were my own two Rottweilers, Axel and Gordon, and I had the privilege of owning them in the mid-2000s. Why did I choose Rottweilers? People often ask me that. They do say that people go for dogs who reflect their own personalities, and I guess being quite tall, I always felt an affinity with big dogs, and having spent time with my then-partner's Rottweiler, Hooch, I came to realise that Rotties have a big presence, but they are, generally speaking, cuddly teddy bears lurking under an awful lot of bravado. Make of that what you will. Now, sadly, Hooch passed away in October 2005. We were both grief-stricken, and we thought it would be some time before either of us was ready to take on another dog. We decided that we would spend the money on a nice white sofa instead and enjoy the clean house and the relative peace and quiet of a dog-free home for a while. And then, just a few weeks later, our house was burgled and quite a few items of sentimental value were taken. Now, as a special constable in the police force, I knew from experience what a great deterrent a dog in the house can be against burglaries and unwelcome visitors of any kind. So we decided that maybe we'd look around for a Rottweiler breeder after all. Now, this was October 2005. So we found a kennel club listed breeder based on the South Coast. We went to see the puppies two or three times before we finally took young Axel home in February 2006. Now, in fact, the first time I met him, he was about 3 weeks old and I could hold him in the palm of my hand. Now, by the time he was fully grown, he was a 50 kilo dog. And that was, well, unsurprisingly, no longer possible. I often talk about that breeder and the process of choosing Axel as a great example of how the puppy buying process should go. The breeder was extremely caring, really proud of her dogs, and each time we visited, it felt as though we were being interviewed for a very important job. And that's how it should be. She really was concerned about where the puppy would be going and how suitable we were going to be as owners. In the end, I felt that she was so attuned to the animals and concerned about their future that I asked her to recommend which puppy we should take home from the litter. I always think that if you can, it's best to build a good relationship with the breeder that you're buying from so that they can guide you on which puppy is best suited to you. Now, more on choosing the perfect breeder in Chapter 1. Axel's show name was Quebec's Atticus, but we called him Axel because we got stuck behind a huge, great lorry on the drive home, and my partner suggested jokingly that we called him Back Axel. Now, after laughing at first, it occurred to me that Axel, A-X-E-L, actually is a German boy's name, and by the time we got moving again, we christened him Axel. There's also more on choosing names in Chapter 2. So, I'd done everything the correct way. A reputable breeder, a long cooling-off period to ensure we weren't making an impulse purchase, and plenty of visits to get to know the puppy before we took him home. In August of the same year, I did it all the wrong way. I got a call from a bloke I knew in Yorkshire who ran a kennel. Now, he had a problem that he was hoping I could fix. Two of the Rottweilers he kept on site had mated, a pair of teenagers in love, and he now had a litter of puppies on his hands. Now, he knew I worked with the police force, and he was keen to find out if the dogs might be of interest to the local dog unit. He was concerned because the parents were both protection dogs with the kind of temperaments that, well, you don't typically associate with family-friendly pets. He very responsibly didn't want the dogs to go to an inexperienced family or anyone who couldn't handle them properly. Now, a few weeks later, I found myself driving up to Yorkshire to pick up a puppy I'd never met, who at 7 weeks old was not at the recommended age to be taken home, and also was from an unregistered breeder. So, they were free to a good home, and free is a Yorkshireman's favourite price after all. I gave that story as an example of how not to do it, and also to demonstrate that even the most seasoned of dog owners can be seduced by the lure of a cute puppy, especially if it's free, although it's hard to imagine such a thing as a free puppy these days. It's also a good example of how what you look for in a puppy can change according to your own situation at home. Had I not already got Axel, I might have gone home with a different pup. But again, I asked the breeder to choose a puppy from the litter based on the information I gave him about Axel. Now, with Axel already being a pretty much top dog at home, I knew I needed a puppy who was prepared to be, well, at the very least, slightly subordinate. When I picked him up, the guy suggested I take the little one with the flash of white on his chest, who he, well, rather unimaginatively, I felt, had been calling Flash. I decided he wouldn't be called Flash, but Gordon, and you need to be of a certain age to get that reference. The breeder needn't have been worried about Gordon's temperament. He turned out to be the goofiest, softest big baby I've ever known. Having two male Rottweilers at home and knowing the size that they would both eventually become made me resolve to do everything I could to train them properly early on. So I joined a dog training club with Gordon and Axel, which made me quickly realise that this was something I wanted to do full time. I took a canine behaviour management course, got myself listed with the Kennel Club, and a year or so later, I was running my own puppy training classes in the hall at Earls Barton Youth Club. And the rest, as they say, is history. Having Rottweilers was also interesting from a psychology point of view. People tend to think of these dogs as big, aggressive, and dangerous. Now, they can all be these things in the wrong hands, but as most Rottie owners will tell you, they're mostly just great big galoots who want to sort of slobber all over you and cuddle you all day long. Now, this raises an interesting and age-old question. Is behaviour something puppies are born, already programmed with, or is it something they learn? The old nature versus nurture debate. It's been going on since Sigmund Freud was in short trousers. A few years ago, I put a poll up on my Facebook page asking dog owners whether they thought their dogs behaved as they did because of the way they'd been trained or because of their innate nature. The debate raged on for days, but a very few people came up with what I consider to be the right answer, which is, of course, it's a bit of both. Successfully raising a puppy will depend on the raw materials you're working with, the breed, and its built-in characteristics, but also the way in which you lead them to good behaviour. It won't always be a straight 50-50, but it will always be a mixture of both. There's plenty of advice over the next few chapters about how to work with your dog's existing good nature and to nurture more good nature on top. Now, of course, there's also plenty of advice on training a puppy available on the internet and at the bar of every pub in the land. But in my experience, there's so much advice, much of it conflicting.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.